Still the month of January and still encouraging that we to grow in Christ. A new year, new month, new season and such. And so it is that we want to inspire one another and encourage one another to say, let's do something a little bit different with the church here at Hampton this year. Let's push ourselves a little bit more. And in doing this, we know that we have these areas of help that we have to fill out. These are on the table in the foyer. Several of you have filled these out and turned these in. Some of you still need to. And you say, well, I filled one in last time we did this, and I hadn't changed my mind. Well, go ahead and fill out another one and turn that into the office. Give it to one of the elders. Give it to me or so. An area of service. There are a couple of new areas added also. You may want to look at that. But to grow in Christ, kind of to stretch out a little bit and see where can I help the church. And in helping the church, you help each other. Growing up in Christ. First of all, for someone to grow, let's start with the basics. Start with step number one. Step number one, we must be born, right? Can anyone grow who's not been born? No. And so if you want to get to the basics, if you want to start at the beginning would be you were born. I remember some of these teenagers being born. Graham, I remember you being born. He's a senior now, grown up, and I remember him being born. Not only that, I remember your daddy being born. And so, say, remember when he was growing up and such. And so, you know, and so we watch these who are growing up. Born. What a great experience that is. I remember whenever our daughters were born, and it was that we were... They had the birthing room and such, and it was a new thing. We went through Lamaze class, and if you haven't been through that, then you weren't in my era whenever that was the thing that you did. Went to Lamaze class, had natural birth. So Julie and I went through a natural birth together. And she did most of the work, but we were there together with that. Whenever Jana was born and we had that we went through this class, what to do whenever you're born, and having a birth, and so, and there's a mother's part, and that part is great, and there's a father's part, too. They didn't want to leave me out. My part was supporting her. My part was massaging her shoulders or getting a cold compress rag and wiping the sweat off of her and being there for moral support, and so we had our roles to do, and we went through that birth together, and it was, I remember... Julia, remember I love you. But I'll tell this story. And so she was there up at Wadley Hospital and going through the birthing process, all natural, no epidural. You know, this is the natural part. You don't want these pain medicines to interfere with that birth. That's the way it was then. You focus. You had your focal point. You had your breathing point. They taught you how to breathe and the husband's job was to tell the wife, breathe, breathe, and to do that, you know. And so I was over there tenderly taking care of her, and she looked up at me and said, those three words I'll never forget. She said, don't touch me. And so I sat in the corner. You know, we went through that whole class. I don't know when I went through that whole class. My job was now to sit in the corner. But we made it all right, and we had our children, and they're wonderful. And it's just amazing to hold that little baby. Y'all remember that precious gift from God, born. Well, to be a Christian, Jesus said you must be born again, born of water and of spirit. In John chapter 3, verse 5, verse 3, and then verse 5 again, Nicodemus came to Jesus And Jesus said, you must be born again. And Nicodemus didn't understand, how can I enter into my mother's womb again? You can't do that. And it's not that. You're born of water and of spirit. It's a new birth, born again. And so we talk about being Christians, and we say, have you been born again? Born of water and of the spirit. It's a new birth. Romans chapter 6, verse 4 said, we walk in newness of life. Your new life begins whenever you're born again. And so we have that born of the water and of the Spirit, born into the kingdom. You're part of the church now. You know, when Jesus came to this earth, he came to establish the church. He's there with his disciples just a few weeks before he's to be crucified. And he's talking about the church in Matthew chapter 16. And he says this, upon this rock I will build my church. That's one of the purpose that he came. I will build my church. That's why I'm here. I want you to be a part of that church. It's God's plan to have the church. Church, that's you and me. Each one of us having a part in building up the church. Jesus said, I will build my church. And here it is. It's not the building. It's not the roof. It's not the walls. It's not the floor. That's not the church. Many times we'll drive by and we'll say that's where I go to church. Well, this is the meeting place. Church literally means called together, assembling together. That's what church is, assembling together. And we're the church assembled together. And then we go forth. But it's his church. The elders here at Hampton didn't get together and decide, but let's start something. We'll call it church. No, it wasn't their idea. It's God's idea. I will build my church, Jesus said. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Sometime between Matthew chapter 16 and Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 2, you see the Lord added to the church. Here it says, I will build my church, which is in the future. Acts 2 verse 47, the Lord added to the church. And so the church is. And the church is to be added to. Just like we add to the church here. And we rejoice whenever we add to the church. When someone is born again, they're added to the church. They say, I want Hampton locally here to be my church family, my church home. And we grow. We grow in numbers. But numbers growing is not all the growth that we do. The Lord added to the church daily those who are being saved. He said, they're growing in numbers. Now we want to grow in numbers. We want to fill this building. We want to have it packed full. Can you imagine people sitting on the front rows here? Just so full they have to sit on the front row? Yeah, that'd be wonderful, wouldn't it? It'd be great that we're full. The Lord added to the church. Well, what about spiritually speaking? Let's lay aside numbers. I don't want to minimize numbers. We keep up with numbers every week. How many were there at their worship service? How many there were Bible class? How many were there on Wednesday night? We keep up with numbers, but what about spiritual growth? First, you're born again. You make a decision to become a Christian. You're born of water and spirit. You go down into the water, you come up out of the water, and the Lord adds you to the church. And then what? And then we start growing. A little bitty baby is just so sweet and innocent and helpless. It must be nurtured. It must be fed. And you encourage that baby to grow up and begin walking and talking, and they become teenagers. And then you tell them to sit down and be quiet. Right? And then just things change. But things essential for growth. Number one is food. Number one is food. They need to eat. Things essential. Can you imagine having a baby that doesn't eat? And they have milk, you know, that, and then grow into some soft food, and then they go up and eating steaks and such, but we eat. A child needs nourishment, and we're there to help them and nourish them. Well, you know, Christians need nourishment. What do we eat? Jesus said this about the food. He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds out of my mouth, from the mouth of God. He said that our food, our meat, our sustenance comes from the Bible. It's not the bread, the physical bread, but this, Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. And these words, these precious words, we cannot grow without being involved in Bible study. You cannot grow as a Christian without reading the Word. You'll just die. Oh, you'll be here, but you'll die spiritually without continually reading the Word of God. To treasure it, to love it, to read it, to say, this comes from God. I know man wrote it. Peter, Paul, James, John, I know man wrote it. But it's from the Word of God, the mind of God. This book is different from any other book here upon this world. It comes from the Word of God. And then in Peter, he said this about this. Laying aside all malice and guile and hypocrisies, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby. You cannot grow without reading your Bibles. Without not just reading, but studying it. Reading it, applying it to your life, memorizing it. Precious Word of God. As newborn babes desire that sincere milk of the Word. We've got to. Next slide, if you see. In order to grow and mature spiritually, we must constant and careful study of God's Word. Here we have a Bible class right before the worship service that we can go and we divide up into different classes. There's one here in the auditorium. There's one over in the annex. There's some upstairs. There's some back behind the kitchen. And we have various age groups from nursery all the way up to 80 years old or older. But that cannot be our only time of studying the Bible. We've got to be in constant, careful study of God's Word. And then not only do we eat, number two, we exercise. Exercise yourself unto godliness. Exercise is so important. I know there's this struggle right now with little kids on up through the teenage years, and with this, you know, they're promoting exercise because we have you know, phones, which are wonderful, but you know what? My grandkids come and say, Pop, can I have your phone? And they're not here to call someone. They want to play games on the phone. And so they're sitting on the couch playing games. Or they have a console in front of them and playing video games. And the only exercise are your thumbs that get worked out on this. And so, you know, there's that struggle of what about promoting exercise for kids? And they're advertising it on television, the TV commercials, and they're promoting it during school hours and such. We kids need exercise. Why? You cannot grow without it. You've got to go and exercise. Strengthen yourself. Go run and play. Go outside. Spend time. It's wonderful. And so we've got push exercise, something which is just completely natural growing up, that you go out and run and play and do this. But you know, sometimes we have to push exercising with church too. Exercise yourself rather unto godliness. Bodily exercise profiteth little. I'm not against exercise, promoting exercise. Do you know what? When you get to be my age and you go and exercise, you know what? It hurts, right? You go out there and you do the things that you used to do, and you go back the next day and your body says, what did you do to me? You're hurting me. My arms hurt, my legs hurt, my everything hurts, right? It hurts. You know, sometimes it is that you need to, what did I say? Think beyond the box. You know, when we say to sign up for some area of service, you may say, well, I've never done that before. It may hurt me, but do it anyway. It's good for you. It's good for you to exercise yourself spiritually. Think outside the box. Do something we haven't done before. Sign up for something you haven't signed up before. Stretch just a little bit further. Bodily exercise is wonderful, but it's nothing compared to spiritual exercise. And so 1 Timothy 4, verse 8. Exercise, next slide, exercise yourself to godliness. Exercise, training for godliness. It's to be more godlike, to be stronger in godly things. And so you exercise yourself toward that. You practice that. Godliness. That's what we're saying. And so we have exercise. One thing, we worship together by in exercise. When we come together, that's an exercise in spiritual growth. Just coming together. When Jesus said, I will build my church, he said, church is important. This is why I died on the cross, for church. This is each one of us. And so we assemble together, and we come together not just to sing praises to God, and though he loves it, he loves to hear his people, see his people together, loving one another, strengthening one another. Don't you know he loves that? When his children are in harmony with one another and loving one another, caring for one another. Don't you know he loves that? And so we come together to worship. But in that coming together, we have people, I'm sure, we have people who hurt emotionally, spiritually, and they need help. We've got people struggling with sin, being addicted to sin. Not just that we sin so every once in a while, but that sin has entrapped us. And what will we do, church? Will we reach out to those and help one another? Do we know? Are we encouraging? We have those assembled here who are apathetic toward worship or God. It will come more out of habit, tradition. Really not on fire for the Lord, but just here. And we can encourage and help one another. We have those who are assembled here who are lonely, spiritually speaking. Look forward so much to the time that they can come together with family here, but when they leave for the week, don't see each other and are just isolated from the church. And we need to be together. We need a oneness, a closeness. We need to exercise godliness in our daily lives. Not just Sunday morning, Sunday night, the Lord's day, but every day. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, present your bodies a living sacrifice. And this is a daily sacrifice, every day. And so it is that we exercise godly living. We come together, we worship, we live godly lives. Another area that we exercise growth is Christian service. We have these sheets. You can sign up for the worship service, publicly speaking, but also Christian service. We have the Dorcas House to help the hungry, to feed and to clothe them, or visiting the sick. And another area that we can go, and we're strengthened when we go and visit the sick. They're encouraged. We're encouraged also. Preach the gospel to the lost. You know, just Christian service. So assemble together, live the Christian life, serve others. That's exercise. So how's your Christian growth? Are you involved? Are you stronger now as a Christian than you were 5 years ago or 10 years ago? Do we expect that in children growing up? We expect them to get stronger every 5, 10, 15 years or so, right? Something's wrong if they don't get stronger. But what about spiritually speaking? How's your Christian growth? Teaching us, denying ungodliness, Titus 2, verse 12, is another exercise in Christian growth. That's turning your back on sin. You cannot grow as a Christian being involved in sin. Amen. Just cannot. That's what repentance is all about. Repentance is saying, I once lived a life where God was not in my life. And so I turn away from that life, and now God is my life. I want to live a godly life, what God would have me to do. And we've got to turn away from this because we're growing in Christ. And so it is that we continually grow. And so we have this denying ungodliness. Ungodliness is living in irreverent and rebellious lives before God. Think about that. And you may say, well, in this life, I wasn't irreverent toward God, or I wasn't rebellious toward God. I just didn't think of God at all. Think about that. In this life, when we turn our back on that, and God is our life, and we say, Lord, what would you have me to do? I wake up in the morning, Monday morning, you say, Lord, what would you have me to do? How would you have me to live? How would you have me to bring glory to your life? Is there anything that I can do? That's exercise. Turn your back on ungodliness. Turn toward godliness. One of the biggest areas you face in this is who you associate with. Teenagers, one of the biggest decisions you'll face is, who are my friends? Those this next slide. Those who are contemplating marriage and getting married, and who do I marry? Who'll be my best friend? You know, we need the right people to hang around with. But in order to grow, we've got to have the right atmosphere, the right air to breathe, and clean air, clean water. Same thing with associates. Christian fellowship is so important. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33, that evil companions corrupt good morals. Evil companionship corrupt good morals. It says, who do you hang around with? Who's going to strengthen you either in this life, a life without God, or this life, a life with God? And who's going to be there and encourage you? You are not here to make it alone. Amen. We're not to be Christians alone. He said, come together as a church. Be part of a family. And you're not here alone. And don't try to live the Christian life alone. Have your good friends as Christians. The people that you can lean on and talk with. Your close associates. Christians. We need Christian homes. And fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. The world needs an example of Christian homes. They need to see a mother and father that love as Christ would have them love, and bringing up their children as Christ would have them bring up their children. And they need to see these children loving and respecting their parents as Christ would have them to do that. And let me tell you, that shines in a world of darkness. Sometimes you may say, well, I'm not doing much for the church. You know, I'm busy with my kids, and that they just consumed, our family consumed my time. And you know what? That is so important. To have a family that spends time with one another. To have a family that is where God is ahead. And the parents are godly parents. And the children respect that. And you can see it, that respect it. And the growth there. Parents with children still at home, you are a light shining in the darkness. You have but a few years, a few short years, right? Those of us who've had our kids go through our homes and now they're out on their own, you know how brief it was that they were with us. Let your light shine, parents. If we can help you and encourage you in building the Christian home, those who have been through it, we'd love to do whatever we can to help you. We know how important it is to bring up your children where they love God and live godly lives and live a Christian life. Let your light shine. So important. And last of all, I'll leave you with this verse. The last verse that Peter wrote, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. Grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Continue growing. Grow and purposefully grow. You've been born again, or maybe you haven't been born again. Maybe it is that this morning you say, I've been thinking about becoming a Christian, but I just haven't taken that step. I've talked about it. Maybe you've talked to your friends. Maybe you've talked to your parents. Maybe you've talked to your preacher about it. And that, you know, today would be the day to do it. To take that step and say, I want to become a Christian. I want to take that step in being born again. I know I need to. I know it's something that I've been planning on doing, but I just haven't done. Why not this morning? Jesus paid it all. Oh, I hear the Savior say, all to Him I owe, isn't it? We'll get to that part. Yes, you do. He paid the ultimate price for you. What will you give to Him? If you wish to become a Christian, if you wish to respond to the gospel in any way, won't you come right now while we stand and while we sing?